to teach them how to build a good fishing net.
It's very hard not to accept nice and good challenges.
They all gather here on ANC, the ABS-CBN News Channel, as they talk about
Managing Asia. I'm Christine Todd.
Managing Asia, Saturdays, 8:30 a.m.
Welcome back to Talkback. We asked our friends on social media if they think the government should probe the alleged election cheating in 2004 and 2007. Here are some of their answers. On Facebook, Dan Vergara says the government should investigate for these reasons: quest for truth, rewriting history, initiating electoral reforms, and punishing the offenders if proven guilty. Lionel Apelado says investigations on corruption anomalies and now this election fraud would definitely divide our time and resources. This could make another failed attempt to put GMA behind bars. Meanwhile, Pat de Maclid says we should do it for closure, but please let DOJ or COMELEC do it. Investigations should be done not by politicians who will just do it for personal interest. Ron also wants an investigation, but she says these should not be limited only to high-ranking officials. Gabby Go Balawag says, for the purpose of knowing how they managed to pull it off, yes. For the purpose of knowing who actually won, no need. We also ask the men and women on the streets about this topic. Here's what they have to say.
Tingin ko hindi na dapat, kailangan alamin na lang kung sinong punot dulo ng ano, ang utak ng dayan.
Kung yan ang hinihingi ng pagkakataon, bakit hindi? Para malaman ng taong bayan ang katotohanan.
Para malaman po kung ano yung mga pagkakamali ng mga naunang tumakbo at saka malaman din kung ano yung totoo.
Oo naman, dapat naman para malaman yung katotohanan kung sino ba yung dapat umupo at hindi dapat umupo. Dapat talagang imbestigahan para lahat po ng mga mamamayan na sumusubaybay ng tungkol sa eleksyon, dapat po rin nilang malaman.
Okay, still with us, Attorney Rona Caritos, Project Director of the poll watchdog group Lente, or Legal Network for Truthful Elections, and election lawyer Attorney Luie Guia. Now with us, Attorney Sixto Brillantes. He is Chairman of the Commission on Elections. Thank you very much for joining us today. And we have Attorney Howie Calleja. He is the spokesperson of the PPCRV to this day.
Day.
To this day. Okay, thank you very much. And let's begin with you, Chairman Brillantes. What do you think this investigation, joint investigation by the COMELEC and the DOJ yield as far as the fraud that was committed in 2004 and 2007?
No, the purpose of this investigation is really limited to determining probable cause of an election offense having been committed in 04 and 07. We're not going into details as to who won, who lost.
Yes.
It's more of a determining an election offense having been committed. Mm-hmm. We have to conduct a preliminary investigation that is mandated under the law for the Commission on Elections and under the present law concurrent with the DOJ. That we are supposed to determine who are the culprits for having committed election offenses. So we have no choice but to conduct a preliminary investigation for the purpose of determining only probable cause.
Yes.
For filing the case in court.
Okay, in 2004 and in 2007, there were no reported election offenses to the COMELEC and to the DOJ?
No. There was practically none. Most of the investigation were conducted by the Congress, both the Houses, Senate, and the House of Representatives. When the Garcia tapes came out, everybody was discussing Garcia, but no specific cases were filed before the Commission on Elections or DOJ, except for one, which we discovered only very lately, mm-hmm. one which was filed by Attorney Paguia. against GMA and Garci, or the former president and Commissioner Garceliano. But this did not move.
Okay.
This did not move because Garceliano was not around. The president was still immune from suit, so we could not really initiate the proceedings for preliminary investigation.
Okay. I read that the prescriptive period for filing a case against former President Gloria Arroyo has not yet lapsed. Is that right?
For the 2004.
2004.
The prescriptive period is 5 years.
5 years.
From commission or discovery, as the case may be.
Yes, so that is still, that means to say that puede pa rin.
No, that is beyond the 5 year period already. We are already 2011. The 5 year period from 2004 is 2009.
But the discovery of the commission of the crime then, when was it discovered?
So far as discovery is concerned, we were fully aware that there was cheating as of the time of the elections, which was in 2004. But our position, my position personally, is that the president, having been being immune from suit for a while, she is an incumbent, the prescriptive period should only run when her term expires.
So her term expired in
2010.
June 30, 2010.
And therefore the 5 year period would commence only June 30 of 2010, which is, up to now, is within the 5 year period of prescription. So we can still file the case against her.
Okay. Does the case of Gloria Macapagal Arroyo affect the election of Vice President Noli de Castro?
Well, we're not sure. That's why we're going to an investigation to determine. An investigation for a criminal offense is there has to be direct evidence, or at least strong circumstantial, that both the president or even Noli de Castro is involved.
Mm-hmm.
No? But we are not sure as of this moment. The evidence that we have so far gathered, for example, the affidavit of Lintang Bidol, including the affidavit of Saldi Ampatuan, and even the witnesses brought by Lintang Bidol, as of this moment would not constitute a direct evidence against the former president or even the first gentleman, or even Noli de Castro for that matter.
What constitutes direct evidence?
A witness who would say that the president, the former president, or the first gentleman had made orders or are the brains behind all of these anomalies. Mm-hmm. Right now, si Lintang Bidol mentioned that he heard that it was, I think, Ampatuan, the old man Ampatuan, told him that he had orders from the president to cheat. That would be hearsay, as far as I can see. That alone would not implicate directly the president nor the first gentleman.
Why does the COMELEC need the Department of Justice to do a joint investigation? Why cannot the COMELEC by itself do it?
Yeah, we could do so, but when I discussed this matter with Secretary De Lima, we found it best that we should join. There should be a joint investigation for this reason. One, the election offense committed is within the jurisdiction of the Commission on Elections. However, under Republic Act 9369, under the automation law, even the DOJ, as the prosecution arm, has concurrent jurisdiction even for election offenses. So we can actually investigate this jointly. But then, in the process of investigation, it's very possible that there are common crimes, violations of the revised penal code, which could be violated. In which case, the DOJ will have sole jurisdiction. We do not have jurisdiction over common crimes, those which violates the revised penal code. So if this were a joint investigation, if common crimes or revised penal code violations surfaces, then we can continue and DOJ can take over these common crimes. Insofar as the Election Commission is concerned, we will concentrate only on the electoral fraud or electoral offenses.
Mm-hmm. And is the PPCRV in agreement that it is the DOJ and the COMELEC who must initiate the investigation?
Yes, Tina, we are all in support of this joint investigation by Commission Chairman Brillantes and Secretary De Lima. And We are there to fully support them. And just like to mention that although there were no cases filed exactly in the prior elections, we have brought to the attention of the COMELEC countless number of times of election violations. But with specificity on, let's say, 2007 election, we brought to them a number of Board of Election Inspectors at that time in 2007. But they wanted them to sign affidavits, to come out and to testify. But at that time, our witnesses, our BIs, wanted, let's say, security, wanted to tell all on, an executive session. And I remember even we were in General Santos together with the chairman then, who was a lawyer for the opposition. We also had witnesses when they had the task force in Maguindanao at that time. And we also brought to them other BEIs, but I guess it was not that receptive at that point in time. Mm-hmm. Unlike the term now of Chairman Brillantes, who I've said is very receptive to the truth. So I think that's why a lot of people now are coming out in the open, willing to testify, willing to volunteer information of what they know in the previous elections, 2004, 2007 elections, because the reception, the openness of the commission is now very evident.
Okay, the openness of the commission is now very evident. Does that mean then, if you were to look at electoral fraud, what is the most important pieces of evidence that you must have to be able to pursue even just your preliminary investigation? Must you have all custody of your ballots, ballot boxes, your ERs, your certificates of votes, etc., etc.?
No.
Is that what you are looking at?
It's easier now to determine electoral fraud committed in 2004 and 2007.
Because
we're just looking at the offense, the criminal offense. We're not looking anymore at who won the elections. We don't really, it's not really important anymore who won or lost the elections. What we have to do is determine only whether there was an election offense committed under section 261 or 262 of the Omnibus Election Code.
There was some election offense committed regardless of who won or who did not win.
It does not matter
who won or lost.
This is
independent. You are not bothering with the ongoing cases before the House electoral and the Senate electoral,
the presidential electoral.
Hindi ho inyo tinitingnan yon.
No, that's it. Not even in our jurisdiction anymore.
Yes.
These are protest cases for president and vice president, presidential electoral.
But isn't the count important for you to be able to establish that there was electoral election offenses
the
committed?
Count,
no.
The
not,
count is incidental. In the sense that what is important is there a tampering of documents. Were the results tampered? Whoever was the winner or loser, for as long as we can prove tampering of results. Were there election documents which were tampered to the extent of 10,000 votes, which would fall under an electoral sabotage law?
Mm-hmm.
See, all of this we can determine easily without really going into all the details of how many votes did this candidate receive, or how many votes did candidate A or B receive. It's not important anymore. It is totally irrelevant. What is more relevant now is, was there tampering? Who are the brains of this tampering? Who ordered the tampering? Who are the principals? Who are those who perpetrated the tampering? We're looking for the culprits of the electoral offense.
Okay, if you find the tampered documents, does that nullify the winners?
No, not necessarily. No. If we can find
because if you establish that yes, there was electoral fraud committed, and these are the tampered election returns or certificates of canvas and all of the documents, then does that nullify the victory of whoever won?
Well, if it will adversely affect the total results, we can refer this to the proper body. If we find, let's say, tampering in the case of Subiri and Coco Pimentel, then we can refer this to the Senate Electoral Tribunal for them to determine.
But what if their term of office had already been served?
Before, because up to now, the service, the term
the
of
2007.
Is up, no, in the case of 2007, that will end in 2013.
Yes, so about 2004.
That is still possible.
The 2004 is still active there.
2004, no
some
more.
Some senators, no more now.
No more now.
It's, that ended in 2010.
6 years.
Even for senators.
Oh. For 6 years.
That 6 year term, it has already ended, which means the term has already expired. President and Vice President, it has already been served. For us, it would be a useless exercise to determine who won the elections.
Yeah.
But it would be very important to determine who committed the fraud in 2004 for as long as the electoral offense has not yet prescribed.
There is no corrective measure that the COMELEC can do in the annals of COMELEC history that after the investigation and the filing of appropriate charges, so-and-so is actually the winner. Is there going
it's
to be...
It's not within our competence anymore.
No, will not another body say no, but in Tina, a decision? Yeah.
But Tina, that's not the competence of COMELEC
yeah.
anymore at this
that's
point. We have to remember that.
I know, but that is, you know, I was watching Lauren Legarda today on her news conference, and she says, I know I won that election.
Well,
everybody,
I think
everybody says that...
They can claim a moral
yeah.
victory.
But does that need to go down and rewrite history?
No,
COMELEC
history? I don't think... Because it's not for them to rewrite history. I think it's clear already here that we have two different causes of action here.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
One is a criminal action, one is a protest. So if you want to reinstall somebody, it should be through a protest, mm-hmm. meaning a recount or a recanvass of the election. But again, how can you do the same if the term has already finished, meaning if 2004 senators or presidents would finish in 2010.
Yeah.
So the only thing that you can undo or redo is maybe the one in 2007, which ends in 2013. But COMELEC is not the body to do or undo that. It would be the Senate Electoral Tribunal
who will do that.
Because the protest is there.
Yeah.
But the proof or the evidence of, let's say, fraud or something that did not go right is with the COMELEC to uncover and unearth.
I was talking to Attorney Rona earlier on, and she was telling me that they had a case in Maguindanao of a teacher who actually wrote in a statement, not an affidavit, that in fact she was filling up ballots in Maguindanao, and nothing came out of it. And you support that a lot of the people who had these cases
not only in Maguindanao,
didn't
but
go as far as coming out in the open and
Maguindanao,
being protected.
Yes.
If that is the situation, what can all of these
we're accepting
people?
All of this. All of the witnesses that would like to come out, we will always consider this for purposes.
No, but now that you are the chairman and now that Pinoy is the president, in other times when people when the COMELEC and the president may not be as supportive, how do you now ensure that people would come out? And not feel afraid of
Tina, it's very difficult to convince people to come out
really?
If those who are really behind the offense are still in power.
Yes.
That is why people are coming out now,
mm-hmm.
because there's a change of administration, both in the government and even in the Commission on Elections.
Mm-hmm.
We did not expect that people will be coming out during the term of, let's say, at the time that Garciliano was talking about fraud. Well, everybody was talking about fraud committed by the former president, since the former president was still the incumbent then. It was not to be expected that people will be coming out to testify against her.
But these individuals who come out, Lintang Bidol and Colonel Santiago and all the rest of the members of the SAF who said they had some role in it, these are people who were not at all helped by any COMELEC official or COMELEC deputized official at the time these elections?
We're trying to determine that. In fact, if you will ask me personally,
yes?
I think there are several other COMELEC officials involved in addition to Bidol.
Yeah.
There are. And there are other government officials, not necessarily within COMELEC. Military was involved.
Mm-hmm.
PNP was involved, as now shown that the person who came out, Mr. Santiago, is a PNP official.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And he apparently admits that he is involved in the actual, the post-election activity to cover up the cheating done in 2004.
Mm-hmm.
So these are all coming out now because we have now, as we have said, everybody is encouraged to come out because it started with Saldi and Patuan coming out, pointing to somebody up former president, first gentleman, suddenly Lintang Bidol came out, effectively corroborating what Saldi is talking about cheating in Maguindanao, cheating in 2004. Then other witnesses are coming out. I would not like to make mention of names, but there are witnesses that are coming out, and we would not like to divulge them right now, because there are certain risks if we start naming names.
Okay, when a whistleblower in the likes of Lintang Bidol and this Colonel Rafi Santiago and all the other officials, PNP SAF elements are concerned, do they become automatically a state witness?
No. The determination of state witness is
they were involved in the crime. They were part of the crime.
Even they're involved, they are actually respondents. They will be respondents in our investigation. And if we find that they are really participants in the crime, they will be charged. But they could be discharged when it is filed in court. It is the court that will determine whether they should be charged or discharged and made state witnesses later. Mm-mm. Although we would recommend that these are the people below, probably not as guilty as the others, and simply following orders, where they could act as witnesses or state witnesses. That's why Bidol is very important.
And how is he so far?
Well, he's in jail. He's servicing his
6 months.
Contempt charges from the Commission on Elections, although we're still talking to him and trying to convince him to come out with more details of what he knows.
And as far as you then were concerned as a legal counsel for the genuine opposition, did you feel that he played a critical role that led to the defeat of some of the people that you were providing counsel for?
I'm sure that he's part of the entire scheme.
What was he then?
He was the provincial election supervisor. He's right in the center of the electoral activity. All documents from him, the commission main, goes to him and to the treasurers around him. And all documents which are supposed to report the results would pass through him as the provincial election supervisor.
Of the entire country?
No, of Maguindanao. The entire Maguindanao.
The entire
province of Maguindanao. Okay. He's the provincial election supervisor of the province of Maguindanao, where the cheating was very rampant, because the results alone for the senatorial would show 12-0 in favor of Team Unity. And none of the genuine opposition candidates won. All over the country, not a single province gave 12-0 to the Team Unity, only in Maguindanao. And then there were changes made as we move on further. Originally, si Chabit was number one. And suddenly, when there was a re-canvassing of the election return, suddenly Subiri became number one. So these are all circumstances showing that there were tamperings in the election results for the senatorial.
And did this tampering only happen, or was prevalent, or was obvious in Maguindanao, rest of the country?
No. There were cheatings likewise in North Cotabato and South Cotabato. And in South Cotabato, we have already filed an electoral sabotage case against the PES, or the provincial election supervisor of South Cotabato. She's now in hiding because electoral sabotage is non-bailable. We just charged him last January when I took over in the Commission on Elections. We charged him with the first case of an electoral sabotage. We're filing another one most probably in North Cotabato.
You mentioned that this is easier to prove electoral fraud or election offenses. You don't need ERs and all of these other certificates of
candidacy. Tina, only because we do not have to recount
ballots. Okay.
All that we have to determine is if we could look, we could find several documents, and these documents have already been tampered. That's already electoral offense.
Can you forensically prove that a document is authentic?
Yes. For example, what? Ballots have secret marks, have security features.
Forensic. This is not just, you can actually fake a ballot and make it look like if it's real, but is there a security paper? Is this
there are security papers. There are several security features. There are secret marks, which very few would know. In fact, very difficult to find.
What makes you think that this group that was meant to actually commit the fraud did not have the same original documents with all of these markings?
Because we saw already the documents. I personally saw already the documents. And definitely these are fake ballots.
Uh-huh.
And what we saw were the original ones, which were what we saw in the Congress copy. I saw what we, during the protests of Loren, these were fake election returns.
Uh-huh.
And we had copies of the genuine ones. Election returns have 7 copies.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
What we found in Congress, which is the second copy, was totally different from the results of the several others that we had.
Mm-hmm.
And this we produced during the hearings and the protests of Lawrence.
It's not that the printing office prints excess and that's what the
No, we also presented future. The, we also presented Ernest Printing who printed the ballots, the election returns. And they attested to the fact that the Congress copy was a fake. They did not print that. And all the rest were genuine, which reflected the correct results.
Mm-hmm. And it would be also easy to spot who printed, to pinpoint who printed the fake?
The fake ones, no, it's very difficult. That's difficult, but it's very easy to pinpoint the fake return.
Yeah.
As to who printed it, generally the operators are the ones that printed.
Yeah. Okay, let us read more comments, Chairman Brillantes. From Mae Amparado of Albay, yes, exhaust every means available to get to the bottom of the 2004 and 2007 Paul fraud and make sure the probe wouldn't be a futile political mm-hmm. posturing, hold guilty individuals accountable for their wrongdoings. Only then will the people see that this new administration wants to uphold promises of reforms and justice. From Iber Baltasar of Pampanga, ang pandaraya sa eleksyon, hindi lang sa bilangan, pati sa mismong kampanya. Kung kasama sa investigasyon yan, lahat ay nandaya. Galit siya. From Boy Franco of General Santos City, absolutely dapat malaman ng taong bayan kung sino ang mga mandaraya. From Dang Tirante, I don't know if we should waste time and money for this. We all knew cheating happened. Do we have a way to stop all these? Was there an ending? From Janice Paulino, every Filipino deserve to know the truth. It is our right and it is the duty of our government to unravel the mystery behind this issue. Maybe it's too late, but it's never too late to give justice. The final stretch of Talkback in a moment. Stay with us, please.